Live from Augustana Lutheran Church in the heart of Portland, Oregon, under the leadership of the Reverend Dr. Mark Knutson, we are celebrating the seventh Sunday after Pentecost in joyous accord with Lutherans and believers worldwide. One in the Holy Spirit, we prepare the way together. Today, we are worshiping as one church in person and virtually through our live stream. During the prayers of the people, please feel free to type your personal petitions into the chat. We ask that you help this community take the message and good news of our Lord to the nations. This is a day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
But after 2 years, I'd adapted. But still working at it. Good morning and welcome to worship. We thank the 8:30, or no, it's the Contemporary Global Quartet for what you're doing today and for that prelude, and for all those who will be participating in worship. And we welcome all of you today to worship on this beautiful day in July in the Northwest. And we're here in the cool of the morning. I know you'll stay cool in the afternoon in whatever way you plan to do that. But we are blessed to be in a place where it's so green and there's so much to see in the human family and to celebrate in the midst of the trials and tribulations. So we welcome you to worship today as we come together for the most important hour of our week to give thanks to God for all of God's blessings and then to go out and live to be a blessing to others in that same way. Welcome to Augustana. I see two of our friends, Lena and John, who are back from living internationally. Welcome back to Portland as we gather in God's house of prayer for all people. But welcome today. We are thriving at multicultural, multinational, multi-generational congregation in Augustana, called by Christ to work with our siblings, Muslim and Jew, Native American spiritual leaders, Sikh, Buddhist, Hindu. The list goes on. People of faith and people of goodwill, where love is at the core. And we are called to be active in that love, to weave the beloved community where everyone is welcomed and affirmed for who God created you to be, where justice and peace kiss, and where together we strive to renew the creation for generation upon generation to come. So let us rise for the opening order of confession and forgiveness, and then the opening song. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God has loved us. Let us join together in the opening song, Real Justice.
Our opening song today is a new one for us. There is a couple of adjustments to what's in your bulletin. Follow Jenny. She knows. Oh, there's a section at the end that's not in the bulletin. It's a call and response. And again, follow Jenny.
Yeah. So just follow me. The call and response is pretty easy. The other thing I just wanted to mention is in our bulletin today, there's going to be a substitution. There's an insert in your bulletin. It lists the Kyrie that we're going to sing. And then also, instead of Justice Means after the song, after the sermon, we're going to sing As It Is in Heaven. That change was made because it actually fits better with the topic of the sermon. So just be flexible with us. Let's sing Real Justice.
Real justice for the earth, shalom for all alike. Side by side, let the nations work for real justice for all. Real justice for the earth, shalom. Dark, the world not the helpless. Till all of us are safe, the world cannot wait. Oh, sing it, feel justice for the earth, shalom for all alike. Side by side, let the nations work for real justice for all. Real justice for the earth, shalom for all alike. Side by side, let the nations work for real justice for all. All lives will matter when black lives matter.
All lives will matter when black lives matter.
All lives will matter when brown lives matter.
All lives will matter when brown lives matter.
All lives will matter when women's lives matter.
All lives will matter when women's lives matter.
All lives will matter when immigrant lives matter.
All lives will matter when native lives matter.
All lives will matter when native lives matter.
All lives will matter when gay lives matter.
All lives will matter when queer lives matter.
All lives will matter when homeless lives matter.
All lives will matter when homeless lives matter.
All lives will matter when all lives matter.
All lives will matter when all lives matter.
Oh, say it, real justice for the earth, shalom for all alike. Side by side, let the nations work for real justice for all. Real justice for the earth, shalom for all alike. Side by side, let the nations work for real justice for all
of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Please join me in the call to worship. My spirit is one with you. And the people said,
My spirit is one with you, great spirit.
You strengthen me day and night to share my very best with my brothers and sisters.
You, whom my people see in all of creation
and in all people, show your love for us. Help me to know, like the soaring eagle, the heights of knowledge. From the four directions, fill me with the four virtues of fortitude, generosity, respect, and wisdom, so that I will help my people walk in the path of understanding and peace.
Please join us in the Kyrie, which is in the insert in your bulletin.
Prayer of the day. Almighty and ever-living God, you are always more ready to hear than we are to pray, and you gladly give more than we either desire or deserve. Pour upon us your abundant mercy, forgive us those things that weigh on our conscience, and give us those good things that come only through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
A reading from Genesis. The Lord said, "How great is the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah, and how very grave their sin. I must go down and see whether they have done altogether according to the outcry that has come to me, and if not, I will know." So the men turned from there and went towards Sodom, while Abraham remained standing before the Lord. Then Abraham came near and said, "Will you indeed sweep away the righteous with the wicked? Suppose there are 50 righteous within the city. Will you then sweep away the place and not forgive it for the 50 righteous who are in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to slay the righteous with the wicked so that the righteous fare as the wicked. Far be that from you. Shall not the judge of all the earth do what is just?" And the Lord said, "If I find at Sodom 50 righteous in the city, I will forgive the whole place for their sake." Abraham answered, "Let me take it upon myself to speak to the Lord, I who am but dust and ashes. Suppose 5 of the 50 righteous are lacking. Will you destroy the whole city for the lack of 5? And he said, "I will not destroy it if I find 45 there." Again he spoke to him, "Suppose 40 are found there." He answered, "For the sake of 40, I will not do it." Then he said, "Oh, do not let the Lord be angry if I speak. Suppose 30 are found there." And he answered, "I will not do it if I find 30 there." And he said, "Let me take it upon myself to speak to the Lord. Suppose 20 are found there?" And he answered, "For the sake of 20, I will not destroy it." Then he said, "Oh, do not let the Lord be angry if I speak just once more. Suppose 10 are found there?" And he answered, "For the sake of 10, I will not destroy it." The word of the Lord.
The second lesson is from Colossians, a reading from Colossians. "As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. See to it that no one takes you captive through the philosophy of empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the universe, and not according to Christ. For in him, the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily, and you have come to fullness in him, who is the head of every ruler and authority. In him also you were circumcised with a spiritual circumcision, by putting off the body of the flesh in the circumcision of Christ. When you were buried with him in baptism, you were also raised with him through faith in the power of God, who raised him from the dead. And when you were dead in trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive together with him when he forgave us all our trespasses, erasing the record that stood against us with its legal demands. He set this aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and made a public example of them, triumphing over them in the end. Therefore, do not let anyone condemn you in matters of food and drink or observing festivals, new moons, or Sabbaths. These are only a shadow of what is to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Do not let anyone disqualify you, insisting on self-abasement and worship of angels, dwelling on visions, puffed up without cause by a human way of thinking, and do not hold fast to the head, from whom the whole body, nourished and held together by its sinews, grows with a growth that is from God. The word of the Lord.
For the children's time today, going to talk for a moment about prayer. I know you pray with your parents, right? And they teach us to pray. They teach, when we're young, we learn to pray prayers for meals. We learn to pray prayers for evening, praying for those we love. We pray for our schoolmates when we're young. We pray for our friends in the neighborhood. And children today pray for the world regularly. So children, this summer, I'm going to ask you to think about how you pray and ask your parents, say, teach me some new prayers. Let's find some prayers from other parts of the world. Let's find some prayers from other faith traditions. Let's do silent prayer. Challenge your parents every day. Parents, I know you love this, and grandparents, challenge your grandparents too, and your aunts and uncles. If you stay with the grandparents, say, can you teach me a prayer today? Because children, I know you know how to pray, and you go deep. And prayer is so important, because for Jesus, he prayed all the time. He needed to pray so he could get centered, get himself ready. Prayer can be just a quiet moment in the morning, just to sit. This time of year, it's so nice to be outdoors and sit for a moment, just listen to the birds. Watch hopefully a monarch butterfly go by and other butterflies, to be aware of God's creation. Just to look at a flower and say thank you. So children, a challenge for the coming week. Each day get up and look outdoors or around your house and say a prayer of thanks to God for something you see. Something you see, it may be breakfast, it could be lots of things, but say a prayer of thanksgiving. Because as people of faith, that's how we start our day. We start with a prayer of thanksgiving to God. And then ask your parents every day this summer, teach me to pray a new prayer, or let's find a new prayer. Make it kind of a like searching for something. And you can Google things today and find prayers everywhere, or some books will have prayers. And find different prayers, and if you find one you really like, do me a favor. Put your name on it and put it in the offering plate this summer. So I love to see new prayers. And often those who are searching find the best. So let's continue to take time to pray, center ourselves. And I want to give a prayer of thanks. Is that the newlyweds back there? Drew and Arlette, raise your hands. You just got back from your honeymoon? All right. Congratulations. That was a beautiful wedding and your celebration. You were still dancing late on a Saturday night. I had to go home and go to bed to get ready for church. I don't know how late you went, but your friends were fantastic from all over the place that they came for you. So thank you for letting us be a part of that. And they're part of probably a class of 20 new members in the next month or so once I get that organized with some others, because I see a lot here who are hoping to join the congregation officially. We look forward to that moment. But thank you for who you are and for being back with us today. And John and Lena, welcome back. Where were you living before you returned to Portland?
In Jakarta.
Jakarta. Yes, you have been doing work in many places of the world. We're so glad to see you back here today and with us. Welcome back. And now for the mission moment, I'd ask the ushers if you would take the offering while I talk. And the offering, of course, a lot of you give online in another way, so if you didn't bring something with you, don't worry about that. Just put something in the plate. And adults, you can put prayers in the plate too. If you find some prayers you really like, put them in. I'd love to collect prayers this summer from many places. Now, I'll run them by the women's prayer group on Monday morning so they have them first, and then we'll pass them on to the congregation. As we have the prayer today, as Marilyn Keller walks by, perfect timing, we've decided summer in the city is going to be August 21st. We're going to be outdoors. August 21st, I heard it all right. Marilyn, good. I'm glad to hear that because you do the food. So August 21st, probably a little different rhythm. We'll have, since the jazz is that morning, we'll have that service and the Spanish language service. And then by 1 p.m., we're thinking 1 to 2:30 outdoors. And we'll have music from both those services and others. Invite others to come. If you're new to the church, one of the goals is to be, and you probably know this already, the most diverse, inclusive church possible. We're human beings. We never do that perfectly. But right now in this congregation, we have all 50 states in this country represented. And we have 20 tribal nations represented in this congregation. And we have 22 countries of first birth, meaning a member was born in another country, on 7 continents. That's exciting. Now, the World Games are going on in Eugene right now, and I'm not going to stop. Someday I will, but not yet, until we have 220-some countries represented in this congregation. We want to be the church of all nations, not because we're so great, but to show that as we gather in communities of faith, we can weave community in a setting like this that helps to weave a city, that helps to weave a nation, that helps to weave a world to celebrate who God made us to be. So that is our mission moment. For the 21st of August, invite others to join us on the lawn. It'll be safe, we'll be distanced, we'll be a lot of food and music, and a celebration of who God made us to be as God's diverse and beautiful human family. Let us pray. Together, the offertory prayer. Together we pray, blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen. Please rise and join me in the gospel acclamation. Alleluia. Ask and it will be given you. Search and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 11th chapter. Jesus was praying in a certain place, and after he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught his disciples. He said to them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us, and do not bring us to the time of trial. And he said to them, suppose one of you has a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived, and I have nothing to set before him. And he answers from within, do not bother me. The door has already been locked, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. I tell you, even though he will not get up and give him anything, because he is his friend, at least because of his persistence, he will get up and give him whatever he needs. So I say to you, ask, and it will be given you. Search, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who searches finds, and for everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Is there anyone among you who, if your child asks for a fish, will give a snake instead of a fish? Or if the child asks for an egg, will give a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? The Gospel of the Lord.
Seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snows in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine and soft, refreshing rain. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. So thank the Lord, oh thank the Lord for all his love. Time and the harvest, our life, our health, our food. No gifts have we to offer, for all thy love imparts. But that which thou desirest, our humble, thankful hearts.
Musicians in this congregation and lay leaders. Wonderful work. We love to hear it. Marilyn Keller, thank you for that piece just now to center us for this time. Thank you, Andy Fort, for your leadership with the contemporary band, Mark Fote, Barbara Passot, Mark Mummy, Jenny Schmidt, and reading for the first time, Mark Lusich. Thank you. And on the sound today, thank you to the younger Fort, Nate, and Peggy Thatcher, and to ushers Jeremy Ansel and Glenn, and all the others, and Dennis. It's been an exciting week. On Friday, after celebrating my wife Tamara's birthday, and I went all out Friday because life has been different lately with things happening around us. I did a little work too, but it was mainly a birthday day. And after we finished up in the evening on Friday night, I said, "Do you mind if I run to Eugene tomorrow?" And she's so gracious, she said, "Of course." So as Marilyn was down singing in a vineyard in Dayton and other pieces, helping to dedicate things with the NAACP in Philomath, of a historic cemetery, I went to Eugene. And it was a great evening yesterday, but I went there without a ticket. My father always taught me there's always a ticket. And that's how I think of heaven. There's a ticket for everybody. Don't even need one to get on board. But in terms of going to events, I love going places where there's energy. I don't care how tired I am, I know if I go. It's like going to church. You may wake up on a Sunday morning tired, and then if you come to church, you're going to leave energized. Ready for the week ahead, seeing other human beings, praying for each other, singing together. So I went to Eugene with no ticket, headed out. You know, it's one of those moments you almost say, "Well, I'm not going to go. I'll just stay in Portland, clean the house, watch it on TV tonight." But there's something that's in my blood that says, "You better go." And so I went, got down to Eugene. walked through the crowd, saw friends I ran track with a number of years ago, a couple four-minute milers who are now a little bit older. They don't run that fast. But we were talking, and I got to the place where I think I can find a ticket, and the one guy I know said, Mark, there's none. Not a ticket anywhere. It's all sold out. So I sat there, and I kind of walked around and talked to some people, talked to some of the young people selling T-shirts, and then I came back through, and one of them said, there's some people over here. They got a ticket. So there are three educators from New York, and I told them, I was going to call them out on the sermon today. I told them what church. I'm always trying to expand the base. But the Howie, Gina, and Derek. Howie, a physical education instructor in New York City. Gina, a principal of a grade school in New York. Derek, who is a math teacher. Those three, they said, yes, we have a ticket. I said, what did you pay for it? They said, don't worry about what we paid. And they asked for a certain amount, and I gave it to them, and we went in as new friends. It was beautiful to go up there and sit and enjoy and celebrate seeing athletes from every nation on the earth, not at war, but relishing being together, whether they won or they lost. It was pure beauty. You know, I think our young people know to work at what you work at, whether it's mathematics or music, soccer or track, or whatever your interests are, it takes work. And it takes silence, too. It takes prayer. Prayer. After watching Sydney McLaughlin win the 400 meters over hurdles in world record time, she, like so many, sat down on the track, said later she just wanted to be, as the crowd roared. Prayer is like that sometimes. We just want to be, to give thanks. So today, that was just the introduction to the sermon. We're going to open with a prayer. I'm going to ask you to pray it together with me, but one stanza at a time. You know the Lord's Prayer. The first two stanzas speak of God, giving thanks to God. It speaks of God's kingdom. God's will. Speaks about daily bread. Speaks about forgiveness. Speaks about being not led into temptation. And then it has that glorious ending of who God is. So I'm going to say it one part at a time. If you would repeat it, and then we'll have some silence. And just reflect on what you just said. Because we often say this prayer in just such a rote manner. But just dwell on it for a moment. Let us pray. Our Father, Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Jesus was praying in a certain place, we're told in the book of Luke. And after he'd finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught his disciples. Jesus said to them, when you pray, say, Abba, Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. And do not bring us to the time of trial. In the Gospel of Luke, Luke spends as much time as any of the Gospels speaking of Jesus' prayer life. You couldn't be Jesus without being a person of prayer. Here in the reading from Colossians, we cannot be followers of Jesus. Well, now we can always be followers, but go deep in our journey as disciples, we need prayer. And we need to pray for one another. Jesus prayed continuously in the Gospel of Luke. Chapter 3, verse 2. Jesus was praying after he was baptized in the Jordan, when the Holy Spirit descended upon him bodily form like a dove. In chapter 6, Jesus prays before choosing the 12 disciples. He spends the night in prayer to God. What a lesson in leadership development. In Luke 9, Jesus was praying near his disciples before Peter proclaimed the Messiah of God, after which Jesus then predicts his own death and resurrection. Chapter 9, verses 28 to 32. At the Transfiguration, we are told while Jesus was praying in the presence of Peter and James and John, Moses and Elijah appeared. The importance of prayer in Jesus' life underscores the importance of prayer in our lives as people of faith. Prayer is central to us. I remember when 9/11 took place, and most of the young people have no clue what that was about. Anything before you were born is ancient history often. Well, you have a clue. You know the history you've learned. But I remember I was asked to write a national piece for a magazine for youth and young adults called M. Louie. And they'd asked me to write an article on the Lord's Prayer. When 9/11 struck, I was in the middle of writing that magazine article. And I remember the tone I took before it happened and after it happened. Not one of rushing off to war, but talking about a God who is the God of all humanity. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And we hallow God's name as we honor one another as human beings on this earth. And to talk about forgiveness, to talk about bread, to talk about daily life, temptation to rush off to do vengeance, which nations often do, rather than stepping back and going to root causes why there is conflict on the earth. Sometimes you write something in the midst of something else and you wonder how it's going to come out, and it came out, I guess, pretty good, I was told. But with the Lord's Prayer, how can you go wrong if you interpret it with the grace of God? Prayer is central to our lives. As human beings, we pray for forgiveness, and it's an important thing to teach our young people and ourselves. We're our own worst critics, to realize that there is forgiveness again and again and again and again. As I've said before, someone wrote, God is like a computer when you push delete, because God deletes all the stuff about us. We're forgiven, move on, be new, learn from our mistakes, but go forward with a hope, a new creation each and every day. Forgiving others keeps us real. There's nothing worse than carrying something against somebody else for a long time. It just eats away at you. But to be able to forgive, well, there may be boundaries in that forgiveness sometimes, but to be able to forgive for your own sake as well as that of others can bring renewal. It's interesting, though, that often we talk about forgiveness, and then we have a lesson like today in Genesis. There's a wonderful article in the Christian Century I want to share with a group, a Bible study later this summer, on how do we deal with violence in Scripture? How do we deal with it? Oftentimes, the story of Abraham and God going back and forth on Sodom and Gomorrah, the point is that God was willing to bargain with Abraham, and Abraham was bargaining, but often they say that, no, what Abraham was trying to see if God was a just God or a vengeful God. And the storyline that often is not lifted up is God was willing to say that if a few people were to stand Just a few. Now you think about it. Sometimes people say, what can one person do? What can one group of people do when things be going the wrong way? One small group standing up for what God is about in God's kingdom can make all the difference in the world in changing minds and hearts and attitudes and a society itself. That's at the heart of the story. God, it's only 10 after starting. It's kind of like Tevye and Fiddler on the Roof. That's where he got that negotiating power from, reading the story. But, you know, well, come on, God, maybe 50, no, 40, 30, 10, down to 10. Well, a couple make it out. But the point is, God was willing to save that city and that story. It's a metaphor for God trusting that even a few can change what is. Never forget that. Even a few of you. To go out and say, we need to take care of our children and make sure their education is the best it can be. Even a few of you stand up and say, let's make sure people have enough to eat. Even in a few of you stand up and say, let's end war. You never know when you go out with the Spirit of God and trust in a God who provides, what might happen. Hallowed be thy name. And then Jesus tells two stories, one about a neighbor who has an unexpected guest show up. Could have been a stranger for all we know, but someone's shown up at that house. And the friend goes to the friend's house and starts to pound on the door. Now, the story that lying there often is it's the persistence of the friend. Finally, the one upstairs can't stand the racket anymore and goes down and gives him some bread. But there's another take on this story, too, that the one who's beating at the door saying, I need some bread, 3 loaves to feed this unexpected guest, is shameless in his shouting out. Think about that, shameless. Important, no, what's that word? I can't think of it. But impetuous, whatever you want to call it, refuses not to stop beating at the door because somebody is hungry right here. Oh, Christians, what if we beat on the doors of power in this country and say, people are starving, people are houseless, they're not the enemy. There are people who are so down on their luck in their life looking for something to eat. What if we as Christians were shameless in our beating on the door? You know, often in the Lord's Prayer, we talk about forgiveness and not being led into temptation. But what if we had the ethic of bread for the world in the same way, which is the first petition? What if we had a theology of bread that says we must demand that the world have enough to eat? You know, I read the story of the first lady of Ukraine. Olena Zelensky, she's on the cover of Time magazine last week, and then she spoke to Congress this past week, and what a courageous person, her whole family, her husband, her children. And in the article in Time magazine, she talked about food, but she talked about also the mental health of the children in Ukraine. You cannot grow up in a war zone without being damaged. So she talked about how important healing and hope. So as people of faith, how do we work for healing and hope in the world, for food, enough? There was hope even when Russia and Ukraine decided to let the grain go out. It'll go to Southern Africa where people are starving and other parts of the world, countries everywhere where grain is dependent. And yet, the war continues. My siblings in Christ, the Lord's Prayer reminds us of a God who gives beyond what we give. Even if a child asks you for something, won't we give a child good gifts? And yet the child in this story is asking for fish, for food. As is the neighbor beating on his neighbor's house. As we read the Lord's Prayer, as we pray it, stop this week on each petition and just go deep for a few minutes. What does that mean for us as a community of faith? What does that mean for ourselves? What does that mean for the world in which we live? Well, it's summertime. You're not supposed to preach as long. Only had one ending. I'll do two today. Prayer leads to hope. Prayer leads to centeredness. Prayer leads to joy. Prayer leads to loving in ways we did not imagine to make a difference in the world. Prayer not only lives for our own forgiveness, but the forgiveness of others. Prayer leads to bread for the world, literally, that all may have enough. So as we go forth this day, let's go forth centered in prayer as we enter the month of August in just a few days. And let us think of the world in which we live and the hope that we carry with us each and every day. Prayer was central to the life of Jesus. It is central to the life of this congregation. You cannot act without prayer. You cannot act justly and kindly without prayer. We need it to center ourselves Oh, just like those athletes in Eugene. I think of prayer. I think of those last night I saw, and I'm going to go to Eugene again this afternoon with no ticket. So if you got one out there, I'm not afraid to ask from the pulpit. Meet me at gate number 2 at about 3:45. But, you know, because, you know, these World Games, you know, we need an Augustana hat that's bright and cheery. But let us be inspired when we see this, because every nation on the earth is represented. Last night when we finished up, my friends Howie and Gina and Derek, I was going to give them my shoes. He goes, Mark, I didn't see those Nike shoes like that before. Oh, we have Nike Columbia Sports. No, let me just finish. Nike Columbia, Under Armour, Adidas represent this congregation. So I wear a little bit of everything. This is Adidas. My shoes are Nike. I won't say what Under Armour I got on. I got a T-shirt, I think. But the point is this. As we go forward today, may we go forward centered in prayer, but think of celebrating the human family we are part of, claiming its diversity. This country needs to hear more and more every day from people of faith, even if you're just a small group to begin with, that takes on all those barriers that people will put up of race and white supremacy. No, that's not God's vision for anything. No, ours is a kingdom made of people of every background, and it's a beautiful thing to see. That's why I want to go to this meet tonight. I want to see that vision one more time. Last night, when the meet ended, and I stayed for the medal ceremony, oh, I got excited because I got to look out on that track, and I got to hear the national anthems, not just the United States, but of Portugal, Ethiopia, Kenya, Grenada. Wow, it was celebrating who we are as a human family, and it was thrilling. After the race, we took pictures with Howie and Gina and Derek, and then we had a delegation from Jamaica in front of us, and we all had the Jamaican flag, and we're taking a picture together. It was fun, and then I had to stay and walk around the stadium and meet athletes from all these other different countries and just chat for a couple minutes and say how glad we are for who you are and where you are from. That is the human family. You know, as I thought about that last night, I thought, well, you know, what's that great line in Field of Dreams? Isn't this heaven? No, it was only Hayward Field and Eugene, but it was a vision of what heaven's all about, that we call to God, may your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What is God's will? It's to celebrate who we are as humanity, to make sure everybody's fed, to pray for one another, walk with one another, and never to stop. It doesn't have to be a world of war. It can be a world of hope. We were in Salem a couple weeks ago, thanks to our young people, a few voices standing up to end gun violence. And so they started to learn the chant. This is what democracy looks like. This is what democracy looks like. Well, last night and today, as we think of the world in which we live and the beautiful thing of the human family, this is what humanity looks like. This is what God's kingdom looks like. Show me for a moment. Repeat after me. This is what humanity looks like. This is what God's kingdom looks like. Oh, this is what love looks like. You're doing all right. One more time. This is what humanity looks like. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Just a reminder that we are substituting the song that was in the bulletin with the inserts. So join us.
And it's the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Come and let your glory, come and let your glory fall. Our Father, who art in heaven, the rocks cry out your fame. Come and let your glory, come and let your glory fall. We will sing a new song. We will sing a new song. We will
Please rise and join me in our act of faith. We believe in God, Mother and Father of all, who has called us all to work together to build a new world of unity and peace. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God, and our brother, who suffered, died, and rose again for us, that we might learn to live for others and find hope in his victory over death. We believe in the Spirit, in the power of truth, of peace, and of love. We believe in the church, the unity and fellowship to which all are called, that we may heal the shattered world and find a new and better life through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Gracious God, we pray today for the nations of the earth that will see the joy of coming together, not to be in conflict and war. We pray for our communities that we will see the beauty in one another and each night go to bed with a prayer of thanks and wake up with a prayer of hope. We pray for our children and youth who are leaders today that they will grow strong in their prayer life as they move into life to bring new gifts to help the world heal and have love. And we pray today for those on our prayer list, in particular Pat Gebhardt, who is still in the hospital, and others who are healing. Be with us as we pray for each and every one of them and others we know of every day. And we pray for the people of Ukraine, that the Russian war will end, that bread that they are so abundant in times of peace will be made available in the world. And we pray for the nations of the earth, that we will again see our shared and beautiful humanity, your kingdom on earth. Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Now may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
And let us share the peace of Christ in an appropriate way today. Communion, when it is time, I would ask Patty and Tom if you would assist, Rebecca if you'd assist, Marilyn if you'd assist, and Mark who read today if you'd assist with communion today, when the time comes. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks and praise to God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed our duty and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious gift of Jesus Christ, our Savior, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin and who in dying has destroyed death and in rising has brought to us eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection with earth and sea and their creatures, with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 holy Lord,
God of power and might,
heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest.
Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory and great love. You sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and the suffering, who preached good news to the poor, who welcomed the stranger, lifted the child, and let the oppressed go free, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and gave it for all broken, and gave it to all, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together we pray,
Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
The Lord's Supper is prepared. All are welcome to receive it, certainly. We'll have two stations as you come forward. There'll be a tray with the bread, and you'll just take your own bread as the words are said to you. And the chalice, one, the first has wine, the second juice. Please just dip your bread in the chalice as the blood of Christ is shared. Again, all are welcome. Thank you.
Please rise. As you are able. Now may the body and precious blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you this day into life everlasting. May you depart in peace. Let us pray. Well, God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As you go out this day, go out with God's blessings and the closing song. May you go forth in joy and return in peace. May the mountains and the hills burst into song at your coming. May the trees of the field clap their hands. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Spirit. Amen. Thank you all.
People of God, go in peace and serve the Lord with great gladness.
Thanks be to God.
May your kingdom come, that justice may reign. May your kingdom come, that justice may reign.